all the stalwarts.
Srinivasa, let's start. Will that be fine?
Yes, yes.
You can start. You decide how many should join, and then
you start. Yeah. So we already 166. I guess then now people will join in as we progress. Yeah. Good evening, everyone, and I welcome you all to the 8th series of our wonderful series called as Local for Vocal, which was being coined up by the very chairman of Thane Branch, that is CSU Bhagwan Asaba. The very idea behind this series is to encourage local speakers to come up and just share their professional knowledge with us. We have got a wonderful response from you guys, and with the blessings of you all, we have been able to produce more than 15,000 CPRs in the past 2 months. Every seminar we have had an attendance of approximately 200 people on an average, and we are really grateful for all these things that you have been providing us, all the support that you have been providing us. Today's session is a very interesting session. A unique session, I would say. The company is hacked and opened the doors for the CSR activities, which was being made mandatory to the companies, and how CA professions could help them and develop a new stream of profession or a professional income, I could say, or an opportunity, I would say, will be discussed today. And for this, we have a very experienced CA Makran Joshi sir with us. Now, without any further ado, I would request CSU Bhagwan Asaba sir to present his opening remark to begin the session with.
Thank you, CS Opnil Kolte, respected members, seniors in profession, and my colleague in Thane branch. I, on behalf of Thane branch, welcome you all in this first day of Vocal for Local Speaker Series 8. We, team Thane branch, are extremely delighted to have you all in this seminar. I recognize presence of CCS Srinivas Joshi sir, past CCM Mangesh Kindre sir. Today, we have seminar on CSR, Opportunities for Chartered Accountants. Very apt subject in today's situation where there is compulsion on certain section of companies to do CSR activities. And to deal with the subject, we have very talented and dynamic and my dear friend, CS Makran Joshi. I know him personally since 2004. One can emulate his professional journey from small team to large firm of 170 personnel. If I am correct, then today MMGC, his CS firm, is number one CS firm in India, at least in terms of team size. Probably we need a two-hour seminar to understand his professional journey from humble beginning to number one CS firm. Formal introduction will be given by our very own and past chairman of Thane branch, CA Yogesh Prasad sir. See the beauty of our series. If I am not wrong, this probably the first seminar or maybe the second seminar after a long gap of last 6 years, I have not heard Makran sir in Thane branch platform. So truly satisfying our theme of Vocal for Local Speaker Series. Now few announcements. We have two more back-to-back seminar, that is tomorrow and day after, on RERA certification and transfer pricing. Again, both the speakers are from our locality only. Please do join us tomorrow and day after tomorrow also. Respected members, today's seminar will be interactive. If you have any questions to CS Makran Joshi, please feel free to ask, but preferably through chat box, or you can raise your hand. So our today's moderator Prasad sir will pick up the question from, or will ask you to raise question directly to our today's faculty or speaker. One more thing, your Zoom name should be your membership number followed by your name. Please do not blame us if you cannot upload your CP credit due to non-availability of membership number. Now I request Swapnil Kolte to take charge of further questions.
Yes, sir. Before moving ahead, I'll just like to make an announcement. We have a talent hunt for CA students over the weekend at the Thane branch of ICI. So I would request all the chartered accountants to encourage your student articles to participate in such events. At the same time, we are also conducting a football event on the coming Sunday, that is the 8th of the August. I would again request all of you to encourage your CA students to participate in such events, which is organized by the Thane Vikasa. Now, without any further ado, I would request the very loved past chairman of our Thane branch, CA Yogesh Prasad sir, to present a formal introduction of our today's speaker.
Thank you so much, Swapnil, for your kind words, and Asava ji for giving this opportunity. Friends, we are indeed privileged to have CA Makarand Joshi amongst us, and I'm honored to be the moderator for this particular session. Without wasting further time, I would just read out the brief introduction of CS Makarand Joshi. I am saying read out because the achievements are in numbers, and I don't want to miss out any of them. And please excuse me for my video. There is some problem. There is a lagging happening in my mobile. My internet is not working properly. So I've just on my mobile data, I've just logged in. Okay, coming to the formal introduction, Makarand Joshi. CA Makarand Joshi is a practicing company secretary having experience of more than 20 years. He is a founder partner of MMJC. MMJC has a total size of 170 plus professionals. That's a huge number. As Asava sir had rightly said, that one of the oldest and one of the most renowned CS firm, particularly in India, we can say. NMJC is a winner of the best secretarial audit from ICSI for the year 2019-20. Makarand Joshi ji is known more for his interpretational skills and practical orientation of his interpretation skills. Mobile app of MMJC on Companies Act 2013 was one of the landmark technology-based knowledge initiative, and it has downloaded of 150,000 plus so far. It's a great achievement, sir. We are very proud of you. He was a member of Auditing Standard Board of ICSI in the year 2018. He is a member of Secretarial Standard Board, SSB, expert group on secretarial standards since 2019. He was a group convener. This is something which is very important. He was a group convener for the guidance note on prohibition of insider trading published by ICSI. He was a group convener for guidance note on CSR published by ICSI. He was a member of research committee of WRC of ICSI. He is also the member of allied law committees and legal representation committee of the Chamber of Tax Consultants, Mumbai. He has actively contributed in the research committee of ICSI for research about the limited liability partnerships. He has written articles which have been published in the magazines of ICSI, ICAI, and business magazines and portals. Writes regular columns in newspapers for empowering the entrepreneurs. He is a regular speaker in last 20 months. In last 12 months, he has addressed more than 100 sessions. Sir, we are very fortunate to have you amongst us. This introduction was a very brief introduction, and I am very sure the knowledge pool that you are going to share with our members will be of immense value to all of us. Without wasting further time, I would hand over the charge to Swapnil for further this.
Thank you for the brief and thank you for this wonderful introduction, sir. I missed upon out, present my sincere apologies, but Srinivas sir, would you like to present your any opening remarks for this event particularly?
Sir, you unmute yourself. You have to unmute.
Now it's okay. Good evening to all. Asava ji, chairman, and his whole team, Swapnil ji, who is managing this particular day, and Prasad ji, who is a moderator. Friends, I think I have so many people known in this particular, almost 200 people have joined, and I know many of you. So without taking more names, I would thank all of you to be here, as well as your, this being an eighth program, I was told, in local for vocal. Your support, not only to the what first is what chairman is doing is just mind-boggling, and secondly, our patience to come continuously and support local speakers is something which is required by all branches, in fact by whole country, to emulate how the local speakers can become vocal, and then they can be really be of their knowledge is on display locally. So I think that is one of the best thing that chairman is doing, and the whole team of Tani branch, and I really congratulate them for this. Coming to Makarand Joshi, I know him for all the years, because his first partnership was done by our firm And from that day, we know him as one of the finest professional. Our firm also does a lot of work with him. Whenever we want any opinions, as you rightly said by Prasad sir, that any interpretational matters, we always look at him. But one thing that is noticeable here, and I hope all of you have noticed this. Today's subject is opportunities for chartered accountant in CSR, which is to be told to us by a company secretary. I think this is where the anomaly is. Local for vocal, I would have requested Joshi sir of Joshi Karandikar to speak on this. For example, another Joshi. You wanted all Joshis to manage this. So it could have been that Makaran Joshi could have been our chairman of the session. For example, a suggestion that his knowledge is immense in company law and all related corporate law matters. So we could have taken that, but the speaker could have been, say, Joshi sir. So I'm just saying something that opportunities for CS should have been displayed by CA and not by CS. But he is outstanding company secretary in our area, and I have no problem of listening to him. I always enjoyed listening to him, but I'm just pointing out the anomaly here before I start. Now, coming to the opportunities for CAs, there are n number of opportunities. Obviously, he will be able to tell us over next 2 hours. I think, first of all, most of the work, what we were doing when we were as young as probably Makaran Joshi, we were even starting formation of companies and doing a lot of company law work, where today as a chartered accountant, we are not doing most of the work. Most of the company secretarial work has been shifted to company secretaries as a profession. Let us accept. I am myself also a company secretary. So I'm CA and CS both, but still I'm saying that what we were doing as practicing CAs have been shifted after especially 2013 Act, when everything was made digital. That is the time the chartered accountants, and thereafter, of course, everything was digital, income tax, GST, everything was digital. But still, we thought that and then the penalties were so draconian that we thought that our offices may not be able to cope up. And we employed, each one of us transferred the work of, corporate law or company law to various company secretaries in practice. This is the fact of life. I think that's why we need a company secretary to tell us whether there are any opportunities for chartered accountant in company law. I'm currently a chairman of corporate law and corporate governance committee of ICI. That's why the chairman thought of, inviting me here for your subject, especially because you are talking today on the subject which is handled by my committee. Now, coming to this, right from formation, which we were doing, as I said, today we have so many opportunities. One is, of course, formation of, every company can have its own Section 8 company or trust or registered society for CSR, which this formation itself can be done by a chartered accountant. Then second is drafting of CSR policy itself, which is generally done by experts today, can be taken over by chartered accountants. Now we have an annual action plan required to be prepared by a CSR committee, or if it is not, there is not one, then board, which we can help them. We have a lot of consultancy opportunities as well in CSR. There are so many companies which want to spend, and there are so many applications which come to them. So we can help them in selecting the right kind of, organizations which would have CSR done for the company, evaluate the evaluation of those applications, monitoring the execution of the CSR. We can help them in this as a consultancy. We can help the company in compliance with Section 135, read with Schedule 7, of course, of Companies Act. Because if we can, I feel company law is a very, very simple, it's written in very simple English. So I think all of us can understand and make, these provisions known to us, and then pass it on to the board who are actually not finance professionals, many of them. We can actually tell them what is a CSR expenditure and what is not a CSR expenditure. We are accountants, so we should be able to distinguish and say, this is covered in 135, this is not. Then, of course, accounting and disclosures as per Company Act is our foray. as chartered accountants where we sign the balance sheet. So accounting and disclosures required under Companies Act for CSR, as well as what is stated by guidance note of ICAI, is also required, how the disclosures are required. We can even help them in disclosure in annual reports, or we can help them in limiting expenditure on CSR for 5% of project cost. Now, here, if it exceeds, then it cannot be debited to CSR project. So I think we can help them in having this expenditure identified, and we can help them limiting this. We can also ask them to, you know, how to transfer unspent amount, when it is to be spent, and changes, or there are many, many changes coming, or relaxations are coming in CSR. Even carry forward of CSR expenditure, or whether we are talking of, you know, the most of the expenditure in COVID, all things we can tell the board that how they can spend now and next year. But I think most of the CSR expenditure as chartered accountant, we can shift to ESG. I think I'll request Makran to talk on ESG and how boards are really, he is managing so many board meetings of listed companies. So ESG being a current subject, how the boards are really shifting these CSR expenditure to ESG, and how chartered accountants who are actually very near to the owners management, because most of these groups are family managed. So we can tell them how ESG is important and how CSR can be done in for as expenditure in ESG. I think as in certification, as chartered accountant, the fund utilization as well as impact assessment, both are possible to be done by any professional. So probably CS can do it. At the end, I will just tell you friends that we have a CSR committee formed by ICAI last year. From that, they have issued several publications which are of great use to the chartered accountants. One of the publications I'll recommend to you is Technical Guide on Accounting of CSR Funds by Third Parties. So how the third parties will account it. Second is Handbook on Certification of Form CSR 1. Then third book is Handbook on Audit of CSR Activities. Then another book on draft format of independent practitioners report on utilization of CSR funds. So these are the kinds of books which are published. And I think these books would be helpful. In addition to that, of course, we can visit the site of ICSI, which will have several such publications where it would also help us in understanding Section 135 and Schedule 7. With this initial remark, I think this would set a tone for what are the great, these opportunities. We have a chartered accountant. And then I think with that in mind, we can start talking about the subject. And I can request Makran Joshi to take over and say something.
Thank you, Joshi sir. Yes. Makran sir, now I cannot say floor. Screen is yours.
Thank you and good evening.
Yeah.
And I was listening to Srinivas Joshi sir. He is the first chartered accountant I had met even before I started practice. He and Vajay sir. And their blessings are with us. Therefore, we are whatever we are. So keep blessing Joshi sir. That will allow me to share whatever I am able to share. And thanks, Asawa sir, for this opportunity after a long time. Thana is the local area for me, and I feel as if I am in friends and not, it's not an address as such. And like Asawa mentioned, that wherever you have any question or anything you want to add, anybody can raise hand or write down in chat box. And then Yogesh or Swapnil, they can help me pause my whatever I'm addressing, and then we can take those questions then and there. And even at the end, we may have some time to have question answer. Now, today I was introduced as an interpretation person who is doing interpretation, but topic is a little different. Topic is about opportunities. Topic is not just about the provisions and anomalies of Companies Act. Today, I can impress you not by throwing interpretation issues with respect to CSR. That's not the parameter based on which I'll be judged. I'll be judged probably based on if I'm able to share some new opportunities for practice. And if something excites some of the members, then ROI of this program is done for Thane branch. Am I right, Sawa sir?
Yes, and now you know we are allowed to have multidisciplinary firm.
Right.
So probably this Joshi sir was telling, but this could be an opportunity. CAs giving lecture on CA forum. Probably we will have sometime multidisciplinary firm coming ahead. Yeah. Thank you.
Right. So let me share the screen and actually, Joshi sir, the topic which was assigned to me was CSR opportunities for professionals and not for chartered accountants per se. But of course, the audience is chartered accountants, and therefore it is equally useful for chartered accountants. I take your point that there is a little dichotomy that I am addressing forum of chartered accountants, but this I don't consider. Although I may not be qualified chartered accountant, but I am empathetic and I am very enthusiastic about chartered accountancy profession because we have grown upon your shoulders, and therefore I cannot deny that. So taking this subject, I'll take a little different starting today, because CSR is the subject of today's topic. And you know, I got these roots of CSR way back in Bhagavad Gita. Dhatavyam iti yadhyanam diyate inupakarine deshe kale cha patre cha tadhyanam sattvikam smritam. Bhagavan Shri Krishna tells Arjun that what is sattvik dana, and this is the best dana. And CSR in the modern format and in the revised avatar after 22nd January 2021, it is exactly matching or going closer to these principles which Sri Krishna had laid down. What he says is that you have to do it as a duty, not as a favor, and do it without any expectation of return, and at proper time, proper place, for proper person, and then it is considered as a mode of goodness, that is Sattva Gunima. And in today's context, when we look at section 135, corresponding rules, it first of all lays down very important principle that CSR is not an option, it's a duty, it's a statutory obligation. Second thing, what they do is they define what is CSR. We'll go through it in the course. But CSR should not be for of your own products. It's some basic requirement. And therefore, you cannot be expecting something in return. It should not be for your own employees. It should not be even for your contract labor, because that may also fall under deemed employee under Code of Wages Act 2019. It cannot be for your own community of suppliers or distributors, because it can be considered as your normal course of business. And therefore, CSR should be done without any expectation in return. And this is not Gandhiji's three bandars, Bura Mat Dekho, Bura Mat Bolo. There is a clear-cut definition of what is CSR. So CSR should not be for your own product, not for any gain. And every year, so when every year 2%, and for whom, it should not be for your own community, and within local area or national priority. These are the places where you have to spend, not out of India. So if anybody suffering from medical emergency, of anybody want to pursue his further education outside India, and company wants to sponsor those are not eligible as CSR, because it is not at a proper place and not for proper person. And therefore, it is out of the definition of CSR. Now, I'll try to also establish that CSR has been an area of focus broadly. Then I will try to elaborate on what is the size of this opportunity for any professional who wants to offer services in CSR. Then we'll look at what is CSR and what is not CSR, because that becomes very, very critical when you are providing any advisory service for CSR. Then we'll look at various services which we can offer in brief and in detail. And then we will end the session. So first is I'm trying to highlight that CSR is an area of compulsion. And why it is an area of compulsion? This is because of the sustainable development goals which UN had set. And they had set a target of 2030. And they had set 17 sustainable goals. And one of the study of Bain Capital indicates that whatever is the gap between achievement of sustainable development goals set by UN, 20% of that gap is because of India. Out of 17 goals which UN had set, out of that, for 10 goals, 20% gap is belonging to, or the credit goes to India, and out of balance 6, again 10% only pertains to India. UN and Bain Capital also say that India is expected to invest at least 4 lakh crore year on year. Only then they will be able to meet these sustainable goals. And therefore, corporate social responsibility, which was a concept which was introduced in erstwhile government, and Sachin Pilot was the minister then, they came out with this requirement just before the tenure of that government ended. This act got passed on 12th of September 2013, some 80-90 sections became effective, and balance sections became effective from 1st April 2014. But what happened is, there was an interpretation that whether CSR is mandatory to spend or not. And therefore, many companies had also taken a view that CSR is not mandatory. You have to spend, and if you are unable to spend, you can mention the reason for not spending. And that would be good enough. But the government was not happy with it, and they had prosecuted some 366 companies. Rajesh Atalaji, in the beginning, I highlighted this point, and he had requested me to highlight about this. There were 366 companies which were prosecuted before this amendment, which happened on 22nd January 2021. Before that, 366 companies were prosecuted. Out of that, close to 150 companies had gone for compounding. 75 companies got the compounding done. So point is, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, although there was an anomaly with respect to whether CSR is mandatory to be spent or not, they were gung-ho about this spending. And another reason is also, you know, and that is the same reason why this CSR have been an area of continuous amendments. There is only one section, one rule, and one schedule. But look at the amendments. Out of 4 amendments which happened in Companies Act 2013, 3 amendments were amending section 135. 10 times schedule 7 got amended. Okay, several times rules got amended. There were 8 circular and 16 notifications and 4 company law committee reports which talked about CSR. And CSR therefore has been a buzzword very clearly, and I'm sure the participants who have gathered here would know that certain categories of companies who have net worth of more than 500 crore, turnover of 1000 crore, or a profit of 5 crore more, all such companies have to constitute CSR committee, and they have to spend year on year 2% on the last 3 years average net profit. This net profit is determined under section 198 of the Companies Act. Grossly, broadly, it starts with profit before tax, you can say, and then there are certain more additions and deletions to it. So profit before tax of 5 crore is not a great or it's not a very high size, and therefore many companies get covered. So the first point which I wanted to highlight here is, because of the gap of sustainable development goals and because of the fact that many companies were not doing CSR 100%, and therefore this amendment of 22nd January 2021, which happened in 135, became a reality. Now, having said that CSR is unstoppable and Indian government will, I don't see in near future there will be any relaxation. There can be more and more rules, as we have seen the trend. The history tells us what can be the future. So history is telling us that this regulation about CSR is very dynamic, and it is getting amended very often, and that in itself indicates that professionals who know corporate law, and particularly accounting also, and the financial aspect of it, tax aspect of it, are the best people. Therefore, chartered accountants definitely are the best professionals to look up whenever any company or whenever there is any NGO which is seeking any help. And this is only going to help. This is only going to grow in the years to come. Now, I would like to establish this point when in this basket of the discussion with size of opportunity. What is the size of this opportunity? So look at this number. This number is available on Ministry of Corporate Affairs portal, and it is also available in some of the high-level committee reports. For example, CSR high-level committee report of 2018. Look at these numbers: 2014, 15, 15, 16, 16, 17, 17, 18, 18, 19, 19, 20. 2020 data is not yet available. This number, the first, second column is indicating amount prescribed to be spent. Till 17-18, this number had gone up to 23,000 crores. I am very, very sure that this number, which is prescribed to be spent, minimum prescribed of 2%, must be more than 25,000 crore definitely in 2020-2021 for sure. Out of this amount which is required to be spent, the companies have been spending in the range of 10,000 crore in the year one to 21,000 crore rupees every year. Now imagine a 25,000 crore rupees as an obligation, which is mandatory for the companies to spend year onwards. It's a huge difference which corporates can do in the social welfare and social upliftment of the needy and the underprivileged or the underprivileged population of India and underprivileged location in India. Total number of spending, if you see, it is in the range of 60% to 85%. So not even a single year, this was more than, maybe this was equal to or more than 100%. And therefore now in COVID period and pandemic, government came out with also an appeal to corporates that please spend even more than 2% and I will allow you to set off. So we'll see those provisions also in brief. And number of projects, if you look at, first year it were, there those were 9,000 projects and now it is three times 30,000 projects. Imagine that at least one or two projects being done by implementing agency, there would be 20,000-25,000 implementing agencies who are providing these services to these corporates. And there are 21,000 companies who are covered under CSR. And therefore, it's a very large number, 25,000 crore rupees approximately, which is required to be spent, 21,000 companies, 30,000 projects. And therefore, definitely, this number one cannot forget. So this sets one larger canvas. Some more data points, if we look at, so where does this opportunity lies? So out of 21,000 companies, which I mentioned in this slide, who are these companies? So 2,500 are listed companies and 18,800, almost 19,000 companies are unlisted companies. So even if you have unlisted clients, still we have some opportunity to play, or even if you have reached towards these unlisted companies, there is an opportunity. But certainly 80-20 Pareto rule plays the role here. 2,500 listed companies contributed 13,400 crore rupees CSR and 18,800 companies contributed 7,500 or 8,000 crore rupees CSR. Now, which this number, if you look at this number, is growing at around, you know, 15% or so year on year. So you can imagine what can be this size. So close to, if you have listed companies as your clients or where you can provide those services to them, then this is the area. Dominant sectors, if you look at education, skill, healthcare, and rural development, these four sectors alone, okay, there are around 29 sectors where these CSR services are can be rendered. This is coming from Schedule 7 of Companies Act 2013. So out of 29 sectors, these four sectors alone, education, skill development, healthcare, and rural development, contribute 4,500, so almost 25%, 30% of the amount spent is coming from only these four sectors. And only 8 states contribute 1/3. So out of 38 states in India, 8 states contribute 8,300 crore. Predominantly are Maharashtra, then Karnataka, and then Gujarat, obviously, Delhi, Rajasthan, Odisha, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu. These are the areas where there are manufacturing setups and large companies are there in this sector. And therefore, fortunately, we are in Maharashtra and we are in MMR region. And this is a capital hub. And therefore, majority decision making with respect to engaging which professional would happen predominantly from the four metros. And fortunately, we are close to Mumbai. We are in Mumbai. And therefore, we have a good opportunity. Education skill is an area where even impact assessment can be an area of interest for us. And if you look at out of this 21,000 crore, which is required, which was spent in 1920, 2,700 plus, so approximately 2,800 crore rupees was spent alone in Maharashtra. So you can imagine, and Gujarat was around 1,000 crore again. So put together, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Karnataka itself is going to 4,000 crore. So this is a huge value which is getting deployed, and we can make a lot of difference by adding value in terms of framing CSR policy, impact assessment. We'll look at the opportunities. Now, where do we stand as a professional? So all the companies who are incurring, spending on CSR, all of those companies are allowed to incur on administrative and overhead charges. And how much they are allowed to incur? They are allowed to incur 5% on administrative and overhead charges, and 5% they are allowed to incur on impact assessment. So 5 plus 5, 10%. So you can imagine what can be the size. Now, one more point with respect to what is administrative and overhead expenses. Therefore, so can an advisory with respect to setting up of the policy and annual action plan, can that be considered as administrative or overhead expenses? Definitely, in my view, it can fall under administrative and overhead expenses. If CFO, now therefore the new avatar of corporate social responsibility regulation, chief financial officer of every company has to give a comfort, a certificate to the board that the money which we disbursed has been utilized for the purpose for which it was disbursed. Therefore, it is not just about vouching, or it is not just about verifying whether the money was disbursed, but it is about actually as to whether the disbursed money has been utilized for the purpose. And definitely, chartered accountants can definitely play a role in this aspect of verifying and giving comfort to the board, and particularly to back up for the chief financial officer. And these services can definitely fall under administrative and overhead expenses which a company is allowed to incur, and which is directly 5% without any maximum cap. So 5% of 25,000 crore is coming to 1,250 crore rupees is coming, and we allow for administrative overhead. Definitely, all of this administrative overhead is not belonging to the services which we can offer. There are many other areas may also fall under administrative overhead, but some pie of that can come to the professionals who are providing these services and helping our government to achieve its objective of ultimately uplifting our ranking in terms of achievement of sustainable development goals, which UN had set for entire world. And therefore, it's actually a social service for which we will get paid. And therefore, I consider this is an amazing opportunity. Then comes impact assessment. So every project which a company is expected to undertake, and if you have companies who have CSR spending of more than 10 crore rupees on an average for last 3 years, and if they have undertaken any project for which an outlay of more than a crore rupees is there, then for all such projects, after the 1 year of the completion of the project, every such company will have to undertake impact assessment. That means whatever project we have undertaken, what is the impact of that? So we have constructed school building. So utilization would talk about how much of that money has actually gone to the school construction and whether it is properly utilized or not. But impact assessment would talk about what's the impact which we have done, how many underprivileged students got educated, how many of them, what was the dropout ratio before you started a school, how that has improved, how the literacy ratio has improved, how the matriculation or school, high schooling, how that ratio has improved. All such ratio improvements would be the impact assessment. And look at that number, there is a ceiling on impact assessment expenditure that can be up to 5% or 50 lakh rupees, whatever is less. And therefore, again, this 5% comes to close to 1,250 crore. And this size is increasing every year, is my submission. And number of companies which are covered under CSR are growing at the rate of 6 to 7%. So look at, even if we were not providing these services earlier, if somebody wants to provide this service, definitely it will be on the right direction. The other day I was reading a book, Asawa sir, and that author had mentioned that speed is important, but the direction is most important. And therefore, if we take the right track, and if the market is growing at 15-20%, then definitely it is bound that we would progress and we would do some good service to the society for sure. And therefore, I wanted to highlight here the size of the opportunity. And now, who can do impact assessment? There is no examination as such, but Company Secretary Institute has come out with a crash course. And I was told that even ICAI has come out with a course on impact assessments, and there would be many other institutions who would impart these trainings. We may have to do this in the initial years in collaboration with someone. And I just wanted to highlight here the education and the skill are the areas where definitely professionals like you and me can play a role, and definitely we can do a reasonably good impact assessment. Healthcare or ecology or water table related or irrigation related impact assessment, we may not be the appropriate person, professional, to do this impact assessment, but education skill, definitely, even chartered accountants can definitely explore this as an opportunity for sure. Now I'm going to the third basket, which is about what is the CSR obligation and what is covered in CSR and what is not covered in CSR and all of these questions. So first thing, which 22nd January 2021 amendment in Companies Act clearly told entire corporate world that if you draw a check in the name of an implementing agency, your job is not done. Your responsibility of undertaking CSR is a non-assignable responsibility. What I mean is, even if we engage an implementing agency, that only means that the agency, and we are the principal for that responsibility. And we can say that CSR is carried out only when the activities are undertaken by the company and not just by passing the check in the name of our own NGO or a third party. And then when a chartered accountant or a professional is giving a certificate that whether the CSR compliance is properly done or not, first he would have to look at what are the activities where which the company has undertaken. Whether it is for promotion of your own business, if you are a biscuit manufacturer and if you are distributing biscuits for free, just besides the vaccination center to the people who have got vaccinated, can I claim it as a CSR? The answer is no, because production of the biscuits and distributing it is your normal course of business. And even distributing biscuits as a sample is also your normal course of business. And therefore, distributing your own product is not considered a normal course of business. It's a very clear and loud communication coming from MCA. And this is going to be one common error which your professional like you and me will have to caution all of our clients that be aware that this normal course of activities are not considered as CSR. There is only one exception or three exceptions, that is all the pharma companies or research companies or medical equipment manufacturing companies who are either in the research or medical equipment or producing medicines which are used for COVID. Then distributing or making their vaccines available for free or making their medicines available for free or making their medical equipments available for free to any NGO or a trust or a society, then that can be considered a normal course of business. And this is the only exception with respect to what is not allowed as a CSR in terms of normal course of business. Second exclusion is outside India, as I indicated that students studying abroad or illness getting treated outside India is not eligible. Any activity only in India is eligible. So even if there are some calamities in Bhutan or Nepal, and if you want to support, you can support, but don't call it as CSR, should be our advice to our clients. No spending should be in the region of political party, because any contribution directly or indirectly to political party is separately regulated under Companies Act, and it is clearly no with respect to whether it can be called as a CSR. Fourth exclusion is employees. Any activity, vaccination or medical treatment of our employees or of their family members or education or hospitalization or any other welfare activity related to your employees is clearly no-no. In the sense, it is not considered as CSR, and therefore we should be very upfront to tell companies that, look, this is not CSR, and therefore you should not be calling it the CSR. One more responsibility is on the, anyway, on the statutory auditor, is because the, in the CARO report also, we have to verify about the spending of CSR. And in the financial statements, in the recent change, which has happened in the last 1 or 2 months before, even in that financial statement also make a disclosure with respect to CSR. And therefore, this is a much larger responsibility. And therefore, what is not a CSR should not be called as CSR by the company. In one of the recent cases in Kerala Development Corporation, it was a PSU company, and that company's managing director was dragged by CBI and has been charged by CBI with respect to a fake CSR activity. And this is going to be one area of a lot of enforcement related activities which you would see as we move further in this context, and therefore we have to be very, very careful. Any sales promotion activity, any sponsorship activity, any marketing activity, for example, providing vaccination for your own distributors, or for example, doing some campaigns for your own distributors, that is your marketing activity, you are trying to promote your own products by making good relationship with your own distributors, that is not considered as CSR. And lastly, the sixth bullet about statutory obligation. Whatever is company's statutory obligation, for example, engaging apprentice, and then it's your statutory obligation. Or if you have been asked by any local government to spend in some local area where you have started manufacturing activity, for which you have already got some benefits like stamp duty exemption, electricity exemption, GST benefit, and against that you have been asked to spend in a local area some crore rupees, then that's your statutory obligation, and that cannot be claimed as CSR. And therefore, this becomes very, very critical for a statutory auditor. And some common mistakes, as I have highlighting, that these are the six areas where these common mistakes happen, and I have already highlighted. One important point is with respect to contract level. Code of Wages Act 2019 says that contract level is deemed employee of the company, and therefore, if a particular temporary labor or such labor is falling under the definition of contract labor, and therefore it falls under the definition of deemed employee, and therefore it's an employee under Code of Wages Bill, then he will not be eligible. And therefore, it's very clear that about these are the areas where you have to be very, very careful and ensure that our clients do not make any mistake. Then some common areas, again, with respect to activities and spending, which many times happen from corporate side, and we have to keep advising them, is one is with respect to one-off activities, sometimes try to be claimed as CSR, for example, marathon, or for example, some cultural activity. It's not a CSR, it is one-off activity. Very clearly in FAQ of 2016, MC had categorically said that one-off the activity cannot be considered as sponsorship, cannot be considered as CSR. If you buy an asset, for example, the company buys a hospital ambulance, or if it buys a school van, and then asset is held in the name of company only, RTO records show that the asset is held in the name of company only, then it is not considered as CSR. Asset should be held in the name of either a Section 8 company or a charitable trust or a society or a public authority like Gram Panchayat, Municipal Corporation, or public authority as per which is covered under RBI, or collectives like farmer producer company, Bachat Gat. So these are the only entities in whose name the asset will have to be purchased. If the company purchases assets in own name, for example, even ventilator, many companies have bought ventilator and given it to some private hospital, I am doubtful that whether it will be eligible to be claimed as CSR. There are two reasons. One is that the asset would be in your name, and two is that you have deployed that asset in a private hospital, and therefore it's not eligible for implementing your project. And therefore, these are some areas where you have to be very, very careful about what is not called as CSR. Earlier, companies used to contribute in the corpus. Now, what is corpus? I am the least educated person in this digital room. You are all aware what is corpus under Income Tax Act and what are the rules and regulations about it. But companies contributing to the corpus of any Section 8 society or a trust is now not eligible as CSR, because the companies are expected to undertake activities. So putting money in corpus is not eligible to be called as CSR. Many times, many group companies form their own Section 8 companies, which will be a flagship, a company which will run CSR campaigns. But they are not able to distinguish which money of which company is spent on which project. And if this happens, then CFO will not be able to give utilization certificate. You will not be able to make impact assessment, and that can put in trouble. And therefore, whenever you have any pooling of money, you should be very, very careful, and you should be very upfront with that implementing agency, whether it is your own incorporated company or whether it's a third party independent implementing agency. In either case, you have to be upfront to highlight that whatever I contribute, what is the project in which I am going to contribute. I need to approve that project in an annual action plan, and only then I can give you that money. And that money will have to be spent in a year in which I have disbursed. If the money does not get spent in a year, that means it will be an ongoing project. So I'll discuss about those. I'll give you a helicopter view about what are changes have happened. But these are some common areas that the implementing agencies maintain a common bank account, and they are not able to distinguish as to whose money, which company's money is spent on which activity. And then it becomes a challenge. And then that would put statutory auditor, CFO, and everyone into trouble with respect to attestation. Now, as we all know, 2% is the minimum contribution which you have to make, but that's not the ultimate CSR obligation. Because, see, first of all, how do you determine CSR obligation? I'm on this subject now. And first of all, every company has to make a calculation of profit under 198. And there are some additions and deletions to that profit calculation under CSR. So what gets deducted from there is any dividend which you have received from a company which is covered under CSR obligation and which is fulfilling its CSR obligation, that dividend you need not calculate under 198 profit. And if you have any subsidiaries or branches outside India, then the profits of those branches also you need not consider as a profit under 198. So that gets deducted. Then you will determine 2%, you will determine average profit, then you will determine 2%. Then whatever is the 2% profits, for example, if it is a crore rupees, and in the last year, you have earned some surplus arising out of it. So it may be interest on fixed deposit, or it may be, you may be running a project of for some physically challenged people, and they may be doing some candles, or they may be doing some bags, and those bags and candles get sold in the market, and it generates a surplus. Now that surplus will also needs to be added to the CSR, which is required to be spent, and that has to be spent on corporate social responsibility, one of the objects of your SBL CSR policy. And then if you have some earlier years, if you have spent some excess money, so this will become relevant from 21-22 onwards. So this year, if you spend excess money, then you will be able to claim set off in the subsequent year. So 198 profit, add less adjustments under CSR rule, then average, then 2%, then add surplus which is arising from your CSR activity, and then deduct your set off which you want to claim with respect to excess money which you have spent in earlier. Over and above that, if you have an ongoing project, what is ongoing project? Your obligation, you have to spend every year 2%. But for example, you are constructing a school building, and that construction of building is going to spill over in 2 years. That means if my 2% obligation is say 2 crore rupees, and 1 crore in 21-22, and 1 crore I will be spending in 22-23, then it's an ongoing project. That means my 2% obligation of 2 crore will get spillover in 1 year, or 2 year, or 3 year, or 4 year, maximum 4 year. 1 plus 3 years is maximum allowed a permissible limit. But so now, when I am determining how much I have to spend, I have to look at this year's 2%, and then also I have to look at last year's carry forward, which I have kept in a separate bank account. That money will also be required to be spent. Now I presume Asavaji and Mangesh and Srinath Joshi that this CSR, what is CSR and all those amendments related programs everybody would have attended in one or two or maybe more than that programs might have attended earlier. And therefore, I would not spend a lot of time in technical aspects, but I would like to spend more time towards a very application of knowledge, which is very, very relevant for us. That's my focus. We are approximately at 6 p.m. There is one hour to go. If anyone has any question, anybody has written any question, we can take those. Otherwise, we can move further. Yogesh and Swapnil, you can look at that.
Yes, yes. I think no questions in the chat box, sir.
Okay.
And it's very lucidly presented, very nicely done. I think we can continue.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. So, we were discussing what's the science. First, we looked at why CSR is a compelling obligation for India and the government because of SD, Sustainable Development Goals compulsion, and overall upliftment of the underprivileged were necessary. So that was necessary. Then we looked at how dynamic this subject has been, and therefore we are the best people to do this service. Then we looked at what's the size of this opportunity, so it can be as good as 2,500 crore and growing year on year at the rate of 15% or so, number of companies growing at 6% or so. So then we looked at size. Then we looked at first is what is not eligible as CSR. And therefore, any wrong reporting happening in the financial statement or in the director's report or in this attachment which goes to the director report in Annexure 2, these are the consequences. So 134, which is the charging section under director's report, the penalty is 3 lakh rupees on the company and 50,000 on the officer in default. Under section 450, we all know wherever there is no penalty prescribed, section 450 automatically gets invoked, and that time the penalty is 10,000 rupees on the company and officer with a running penalty of 1,000 rupees. And if there is any concealment of information or any misrepresentation, for example, something which is not CSR claimed as CSR, then it may amount to fraud under 447, 448. And therefore, it's very, very important for the companies to engage the people who understand the nuances in its very minute nitty-gritty and who are updated about this subject and about the trends and about the trends, not only industry practice, the trends of a regulatory practice more, who is updated and who is guiding, that such professionals' advice would be solicited or corporates would be looking for such professionals. Rajesh Atale had mentioned that I should talk about these number of companies who have been prosecuted. Close to 366 companies were prosecuted under the erstwhile law. Now imagine a situation. Now, erstwhile law, the company, registrar of companies was required to prosecute. Now, what is meant by prosecution? They will first issue a show cause notice. Then if they are not satisfied with the reply, then they will issue prosecution notice. They will file a case in the court. And this was a long-drawn process. So, inconvenient for the Ministry of Corporate Affairs to take any action because it requires court process. Now, adjudication mechanism has been institutionalized in Companies Act. Like RBI or like SEBI has adjudication power, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, that is the local office, which is registrar of company, has that adjudication power. More than 100 plus compliances have been put under adjudication power of registrar of company. This has happened in the last 2-3 years. And one of those important is CSR. Now, in enforcing CSR is going to be the power of registrar of company, and therefore whatever submissions we do, the enforcement and levying penalties is going to be very effective. Everybody must have watched and tracked that MCA is coming out with a new avatar, and they are upgrading technologically to a great extent. And now we know that the implementing agency, which the corporates engage, they have to register with MCA and they have to submit their PAN and QALY ATG registration confirmation, but PAN number is required to be submitted. Everybody must have read, I'm just highlighting and reconciling, that Ministry of Corporate Affairs has entered into MOU with SEBI, CBDT, Customs, GST, So there are MOUs with all departments with respect to data sharing. A PAN number is already there. 1280G is getting monitored via income tax. Income tax has also asked all those companies who have 1280G, all those entities who have 1280G to register with income tax. So that registration is now there. Their financials are there with income tax. And this PAN-based sharing of data will happen very efficiently in a 3-year, 4-year, 5-year down the line. Because sometimes the enforcement may take a little longer, but the compliance is required from yesterday is the expectation from the companies and the professionals. And therefore, it becomes a very, very sensitive area. In the first basket, I had also highlighted that this is an area of a very, very important focus area for the government. And therefore, they would look up to see that the money is spent on the causes which are permissible to be spent as CSR. And ultimately, that money which is spent is making a good impact. This is the ultimate goal, because sustainable development goals, India has to make an improvement. 25,000 crore or 30,000 crore is only 10% of the sustainable development goal investment which in India, India as a country has to do. But still, it will be the government will be very gung-ho about these regulations. Now I'm going to the third basket, which is the latest development. So there is only one slide on this subject, where I will give you a helicopter view with respect to what are the latest changes with respect to CSR, and then we'll move to, in this context, what are the services which we can offer. The services can be offered to implementing agencies, and it can be offered to the corporate. So both level, we may have people who may want to avail our services. Therefore, we need to equip ourselves, and therefore this session, Shiv Bhagwan Asawaji thought it appropriate. So major changes on 22nd January 2021. First of all, CSR spending is mandatory now. And if there is any money which is unspent, if the company is unable to spend the money, then the question, then the concept of ongoing project they have introduced. What they mean to say is that if you are not able to complete the project in a year of obligation, that's fine. You can classify that project as an ongoing project. But that doesn't mean that you get liquidity cushion with respect to 2% spending. That whatever is the unspent amount, immediately after the end of the financial year, within 30 days, you have to deposit in a separate bank account. And from that account, you can spend that money on that ongoing project, which is classified as ongoing project by the board of directors and CSR committee of the company. And therefore, spending is mandatory. Whether you spend in this year, whether you spend in 1 year plus or 1 plus 3 years, but the money will be spent for sure. And if you do not have any identified ongoing project, then the money will go to one of the funds of Schedule 7. So Schedule 7 has four funds broadly, PM Care Fund, PM National Relief Fund, then it has Ganga Abhiyan and Swachh Bharat Kosh. So these are the four funds which are eligible. The money can be transferred to that account. Then the monitoring, utilization, impact assessment, nothing is applicable. You can simply draw a check in the name of those funds and claim that as CSR spend. So this is the easiest way to claim that. And this is a dichotomy, or this is little contradiction, that on one side, government feels that companies should spend directly, they should undertake activities directly, they should not contribute to PM Care Fund because the reach of corporate is deeper than the government. But on the other side, when you contribute to PM Care Fund or such funds, then you get tax benefit, but CSR spent directly by the company is not eligible for any tax benefit. And if you do it via ATV register, then you may claim tax benefit. Some companies are successful in there. And therefore, there is a disparity in treatment with respect to the spend decision which a company does. And very soon, it is expected that there will be a rationalization with respect to this treatment all over. But as of now, money is required to be spent either in this year or 1 plus 3 years, or latest after 3 years, you have to transfer that to Schedule 7 fund. So these are two important changes. Then the another important thing is if you do an excess spending, then you will be eligible to claim that at the set off. So for example, if your obligation to spend as per 2% is 1 crore rupees, and if you spend 2 crore rupees in 2021-22, then the excess 21 crore can be set off against the liabilities of the succeeding 3 years. Up to next 3 years, you can set off those against these activities. Then, as I said earlier, activities benefiting employees and those six categories have been specifically excluded under 22nd January 2021 amendment. All implementing agencies which should be either Section 8 company or a society or a charitable public trust, they should be registered with income tax under 12A and 80G both. It's not just 12A, it's 12A and 80G both. And many companies are finding trouble because the trust had 12A but they did not have 80G. Now, unless and until that trust gets an 80G, new project cannot be started with those NGOs. And all such trust societies or Section 8 companies who have 12A 80G registration valid, they should register with NCA, and only then from 1st April 2021, those implementing agencies you can use for implementing your projects. Another important point, as I have been highlighting earlier, that every year, chief financial officer of the company will give a certificate to the board that the money which we disbursed has been utilized for the purpose for which it was disbursed. And therefore, it's not just about disbursal, it is also about utilization, the purpose and the manner in which the board had approved. Another important point is companies will have to have annual action plan. Now, earlier was what used to happen is it was a CSR was has always predominantly been the trigger or the initiator have many times been implementing agency. So implementing agency like trust society or a charitable or a Section 8 company, they come with some proposal to the company, and then company decides to whether to spend or not, was a practice earlier. Now what is expected, and it was expected even earlier, but now it's coming very, very loudly and very, very bold, italic, underline, that company needs to, first of all, have its own CSR policy, which we'll also talk about which are the thrust areas where you want to spend and all. So we'll discuss about what can be our role with respect to CSR policy in a while. But not only policy, every year, CSR committee and the board of directors have to adopt annual action plan. And what that annual action plan should talk about is which are the projects which we will undertake in this year, and whether we will undertake project directly or through some implementing agency. When I will start each of these projects, how will I disburse the money, how will I monitor the utilization, and all of those, and how, which projects impact assessment I will do in this year, which projects need assessment I will do this year. All those things needs to be captured in a document called annual action plan, and that annual action plan will have to be approved by the board, and only then the money can be disbursed. So if you are doing an audit of a company which is covered under CSR, or if you are wanting to provide some service to companies which are covered under CSR, the first thing which you should ask to these companies, particularly in 21-22, is that have you done anything on COVID before you adopted annual action plan? If you adopted, then what will you do? So this is the first year, and therefore you can ratify those spending in your annual action plan, but that ratification is necessary. Unless and until board approves that, you cannot undertake a project is the requirement. Ratification is a kind of a little substandard compliance, but I would say that it's actually at least a substantive compliance you would do. But if you do not have that in annual action plan, even as a ratification, then it will become a non-compliance, and it's ultra-vice, because we have studied Companies Act. I'm sure there are many seniors in this room, and with whatever I'm sharing, I'm just sharing. I'm not giving any knowledge. You are more knowledgeable than me. I have all respect to all the seniors who have gathered here. The point which I was trying to tell is that in our school days or in our first years of Companies Act, everybody has studied ultra-vires concept. But if anybody does something in company beyond his power, then it's ultra-vires, and he is personally liable for this. So if any management does any CSR project which is not adopted under annual action plan by the board, they have exceeded their power, and they do not have that power. They can be personally liable for reimbursing that money to the company. So this is one area which is an area for asked to provide service. And then impact assessment, we have discussed which companies have to do impact assessment. And then assets created out of CSR. Here onward, all assets, be it an ambulance, be it a school building, be it a school van, be it a ventilator or some medical equipment or any capital asset which has utility over a longer period and which may have some residual value, all of those assets, none of those assets can be held in the name of company. It has to be held by Section 8 trust or a society. So many times at many forums, many tax experts have highlighted this point to me that look, the asset which is not used for business, I cannot claim depreciation. Then why this provision? The provision probably is, has come because although you may not be able to claim depreciation under income tax, but you may enjoy some residual value of that asset. So once the school van becomes a little older after 6 years, 7 years, 8 years, you will dispose it off and you will get few lakh rupees and that will go to the company which has claimed the entire money as a CSR, and that is certainly not allowed. In my view, this particular provision of asset not being allowed to be held in the company name is more like a clarificatory nature and not an amendment in my view. And so these are very broadly the major important changes which have happened. Now in this context, what are the services which we can offer? So far so good. We looked at what is why CSR is the thrust area. Then we looked at what is the size of this opportunity and how it is growing. Then we looked at what is not considered as CSR. And if we fail to identify this in the financial statements or in the director's report or in the audit report, then there can be personal liabilities on the professionals and also on the company, definitely. What are the consequences of wrong representation and what is the trend with respect to prosecution? And what is the new power of adjudication? That also we discussed. Then we looked at what are the latest amendments on 22nd January. And now we are on the point of what are the changes which we can offer. First, I have taken what are the services which we can offer to implementing agency. And then we discuss what are the services which we can offer to companies who are required to spend money on CSR. So first is obviously registration. This has been a traditional area for all the tax practitioners and particularly chartered accountants, that registration of the trust under 12A and MITG. The registration with charitable commissioner's office, the registration with society, or registration with Ministry of Corporate Affairs as a Section 8 company or a trust or a society. If you want to register that entity for receiving, being eligible for receiving foreign contribution, then you can provide them services for registration under FCRA, that is Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. This can be one topic of interest, and I will not touch upon these aspects. Asavaji, we can take this maybe. This is an area of opportunity definitely for the chartered accountants to enable, make the trust eligible for receiving foreign contribution. And FCRA registration is handled by Ministry of Home Affairs directly from Delhi. And what they look at is the credibility and whether it is coming with a clean hands and a clean record. So this is an area definitely for all chartered accountants we can employ. Then helping the compliance up to date, because we are now dealing with not the individual rich people, but we are dealing with corporates. And in this corporate, the decision maker are all sophisticated professionals. So those may be CFOs or CEOs and the CSR heads. And they like to, they like everything very clean, very sanitized kind of a thing. And therefore, their expectation, meeting their expectation is many times challenged for a traditional NGOs who are in a trust or a society or a Section 8 company, because their focus has always been on the groundwork and they lack in paperwork. And this is one area where we can play definitely a very, very vital role, because their returns should be, because whenever a company wants to engage any implementing agency, first they would do some basic health check for these Section 8 companies or societies or trusts in terms of what are their hygiene level in terms of their ability to satisfy companies needs with respect to utilization details, with respect to avoiding conflict of interest, with respect to ensuring that impact assessment data is available for impact assessment. There are enough proofs to ensure that the money has been utilized for the purpose for which it was spent. And therefore, basic compliance, books of accounts, various ledgers, and various documentation of the processes. So there we can play an important role. Then make them presentable, not only in terms of compliance, but also in terms of overall documentation with respect to utilization, work done, how did they identify beneficiaries, what were the, how did they ensure that there is no conflict of interest, how did they identify that the money would be used for proper purpose, and how can they help with respect to assessing impact. Then comes mapping projects. So because companies would be now very, very particular about, you know, ongoing project and utilization and CFO's responsibility, it continuously it is increasing. And now, therefore, mapping of those projects and updating the companies with respect to the progress with respect to project, how capable those NGOs would be. Now, if you are able to build some mechanism by mapping projects digitally or helping them to have real-time data with respect to, or very close to real-time data with respect to utilization, that will be one area of service which we can empower, by which we can empower NGO. Then helping them to ensure that the admin cost doesn't go beyond 5%. This will be an area of interest for the NGOs and even for the companies. And that would be one area with continuous monitoring of the expenses and cost cutting can be an area of for the implementing agencies and for the companies both, because there is a maximum limit of 5% on administrative overhead expenses. There is a debate going on as to whether 5% is applicable only at a company level or company plus NGO level. But looking at adjudicatable provision of CSR, unless and until MCA clarifies that this 5% limit is applicable only at company level, we have to presume that whatever is applicable to company level, it is also applicable to implementing agency level, because implementing agency is ultimately an agency of the principal. So remember this point. Then helping NGOs to have code of conduct because if there is any allegation on the company that this money which you have spent on CSR has actually not been spent on CSR, but actually has gone in the hands of the trustees or the directors of the company or a trust, it would be a very dirty and ugly kind of a situation which no company would want. And therefore, a lot of large companies have started insisting on NGOs to have code of conduct with respect to avoiding conflict of interest, with respect to avoiding political affiliation, and with respect to avoiding or with respect to anti-bribery. Because many multinationals have very strict protocols with respect to anti-bribery. And therefore, adopting those code of conduct, having those declarations from the people who are involved in the work, and that kind of mechanism will be an icing on a cake, and that can make you a complete five-star kind of a implementing agency, which will be sought after by every celebrated company. And then, of course, creating visibility in terms of helping them to document and make their profile more attractive. And then connecting the dots, as Srinivas also said, that we may have companies on the one side and NGOs on the other side. So connecting the dots can be an area. And there are many platforms which are connecting the dots and charging some fees for connecting the dots. And this is an area which is of huge need for the country, for Indian CSR development. So these are some helicopter view of what are the services which we can offer to trust, and there are many more. This is not an exhaustive PPT. This is only a PPT of orientation and sensitization in my view. So what are the services which we can offer to company? Again, a quick helicopter view. First of all, identification of implementation. So doing their due diligence in terms of how clean they are in terms of political conflict of interest or ability to give reports, ability to satisfy that the money is utilized. So identification and due diligence of implementing agency. Then comes policy framing. So CSR policy framing, annual action plan preparation, monitoring review, monitoring the utilization quarter on quarter, and suggesting changes in annual action plan to CSR committee is one area, very, very important area. There can be retainership arrangements with corporates for with respect to monitoring of CSR. Then giving a certificate that there is no conflict of interest and highlighting or flagging if the NGO is engaging any related party of the company, then it would become a related party transaction for the company. And therefore ensuring that the man accounts and the secretary teams are updated about conflict of interest and no transaction is entered into with the entities which have conflict of interest unless audit committee approves that if the conflict of interest is at a company level. And at a trust level, definitely we can help them to verify that whatever contractors implementing agency has engaged for actually implementing, for example, construction of school building or running a school van, you will have to engage somebody who will run those items or construct the building. For those, you will engage in contracting companies. Those should not be from the relatives or the trustees or the directors of the implementing agency itself. And therefore, giving that comfort, because it will be a very ugly allegation if it comes, because the larger the company, higher the chances of coming in media. You know, any show cause notice received to any large company falling under top 100, it would become a newspaper item. And therefore, such items can also become a newspaper item. Whistleblower is always an area of concern for companies. And therefore, this assurance, if somebody gives to the CFO and to the compliance officer or to the board, board would be very happy to have such professionals. And then monitoring and giving certificate to the CFO about utilization ultimately has been used for the manner and the purpose. So purpose is amongst the projects and for the cause, because ultimately this project should be able to make a good impact. This is very, very important. Now, I have seen some projects where crore rupees is spent in feeding milk to the malnourished, undernourished child, and 80 lakh rupees goes in transportation, cold storage, and salaries, more important. And only 20 lakh rupees goes in, 15 lakh rupees goes in milk. Now, what kind of impact it would make? And therefore, utilization, of course, cold storage can be a utilization, but would it make a good impact? I'm doubtful. And therefore, such kind of issues can be flagged by a chartered accountant while not only the utilization in terms of accounting proofs, but also in terms of feeding with respect to this is going in a different direction and money is getting used, a lot of money is getting used into salaries which should be reduced. So those kind of inputs a professional can give. And then ultimately impact assessment, need assessment. So there are two aspects. Before undertaking a project, companies would want to get the need assessed with respect to whether there is a need for this project, and then after completion of the project, after completion of 1 year of the project, then the impact will be assessed. Now, doing an impact assessment is a mandatory requirement, and as we have seen earlier, there is a specific allocated budget of 5% of your CSR obligation or rupees 50 lakh, which here is less, and therefore the companies would need impact assessment. We have also seen some number earlier. There are more than 30,000 projects which are implemented by the Indian corporates in respect of this CSR. And there are 2,500 companies contributing almost 13,000 crore rupees CSR. And therefore, these 2,500 listed companies would have many projects which will require impact assessment. And therefore, if you have any such, if you can provide such service to any client, even in education and skill to begin with, maybe. That's what the idea of sharing with you the number of companies and that data, because the number speaks louder than the language. Although I'm a company secretary, I'm a professional of a language, and chartered accountants is a profession of a number. But I also feel the same thing, that numbers speak louder than the words. So these are services in brief, but now we'll look at some of those services in detail. Whatever I can give some inputs to you. So I'll speak about how do we help them in framing policy, how do we help them in preparation of annual action plan, what efforts we can do with respect to due diligence with respect to implementing agency and CFO, what all CFO should look at, and the impact assessment, how can we improve. So these are four or five areas which I would try to highlight. Now, policy, CSR policy, every company had a CSR policy and they would have CSR policy, but the policy is now expected to give a guidance with respect to selection and implementation and monitoring of the project and guidance on annual action. Now, what can be those guidance? Those guidance can be with respect to what are your thrust areas. So, all large companies generally prefer to have some thrust area. For example, it may be an ecological, geological disturbance, or it can be education, it can be skill development, it can be women empowerment, it can be rural area development if you have a plant in a rural area. So these can be some thrust area. So amongst the thrust area, what should be the distribution would be the guidance which a policy has to be. So you have to select a project, but while selecting a project, you would first look at thrust area and distribution of your CSR purpose in those thrust area. How will you determine that which thrust area I will spend how much money in which thrust area, and what will be the parameters for distribution of that money in various thrust area. Then how much money I would like to use in my local area, how much of that money I will prefer to keep it as a buffer for national calamity or national priority, how much of that CSR contribution I would like to keep for a group level, because you may be a subsidiary of some large holding company. Asawaji, am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you.
You are audible.
Thank you. So guidance with respect to thrust area, guidance with respect to how are we going to balance between local area and national priority. How are we going to, do you want to give some importance to your group company? So I was telling that you may be a subsidiary of a large group and you may want to spend some money in your local area, some money in a group's local area. So those policy parameters should come, that guidance with respect to selection of the project in terms of thrust area, in terms of location, in terms of capability of implementation, in terms of availability of implementing agency, guidance in terms of availability selection of implementing agency, guidance in terms of determining what will be the parameters with respect to making an impact of the project. So these are the parameters which a CSR policy, if it has, then it will clearly distinguish between a man and a boy as far as CSR subject is concerned. There would be large population of 80-90% of the companies who would have a copy-paste or a very high-level kind of a CSR policy, but the 10-15% of the companies who would do a very detailed policy and annual action plan would vouch. You know, Srinivasji also mentioned to me to talk about ESG parameter, and now there are so many funds, and Asawaji can highlight on this, that there are so many future funds who have floated separate schemes to invest in ESG compliant companies, that in environment, social and governance. These are the areas where environment and social comes directly under CSR. Governance is a larger subject, or a corporate governance subject is a much detailed and elaborate subject, but definitely environment and social is an area of CSR directly. And therefore, this reporting, this policy, this annual action plan, and the visibility which a company will be able to give with respect to its CSR activities, projects, it's a robust mechanism, and the impact which is able to make, definitely will add a feather in cap with respect to ESG expectations of investors when they are investing in your company. And we would have seen many times in CNBC or NDTV or ET Now that certain companies fetch higher pricing in the stock market because of their governance and disclosure norms. And therefore, a very distinguished kind of a CSR policy, if you are able to provide that, definitely companies will be ready to give you few lakh rupees for helping in CSR policy and even for annual action plan. And annual action plan, I had already narrated how much every year you have to make this annual action plan, and generally, like every company prepares a budget in the last quarter of the financial year for the next financial year, this annual action plan should also start in the last quarter of the financial year for the next financial year, where we will talk about which project you will do, which quarter you will start which project, whether you will do directly, indirectly, through implementing agency, how will you disburse the money to these implementing agencies, how will you monitor the utilization, when will you start which projects need assessment, and when will you start impact assessment, what is the budgeted allocation for that, what will be the criteria for selection of the agency for doing need assessment and impact assessment. All of those aspects, the agency which you would engage for monitoring and reporting mechanism with respect to utilization, all of that will come in annual action plan, and then review and update and suggestion with respect to changes which are required in annual action plan quarter on quarter. Earlier, companies used to do CSR committee once in a year or maximum twice in a year, but now I'm sure all large companies will have CSR committee almost every quarter, and they will review this annual action plan every quarter. And this support service, somebody will be providing, whether you or me or somebody else. That's the only option which we and company have. Now we come to, so I want detailed analysis with respect to what are the services which we can offer and how can we distinguish our, how can we build our credibility and credential in terms of our offering, is my humble attempt to share with the my dear friends who have gathered from Thane. So obviously, while selecting implementing agency, first thing is 12A-18G certificate and MCA registration. But more important comes with the financial performance, financial and performance track record, and credibility. Somebody has raised hand.
Yogesh? Actually, continue. Kijiye. Last, there are certain questions which will be taken by Prasad, sir.
Okay, sir. We did not want to disturb you.
Sure, no problem.
Thank you.
Maybe 15 minutes more, and
yes, surely, surely.
Yes, yes.
I'm on the. This is the most important part of the today's session, which is what are the services and what do we expect? What are we? What is the expectation from us? So when somebody is doing a, what is expected from implementing agency? And if you are able to match those, then it's definitely going to help implement at implementing agency level. This is going to be useful for attracting CSR. And from a corporate side, we would look at these. So how are they equipped to support us for need assessment, impact assessment, and risk coverage? Risk coverage related to accidents, risk coverage related to financial risk, risk coverage with respect to conflict of interest, risk coverage with respect to bribery, because these are the local level projects and you may have to require a lot of local permissions, and therefore, and if you are a US-based company, SOX and other US anti-bribery regulations become very, very important, and therefore those comforts also you would verify when you do due diligence. Documentary proof, again, a third-party checks, how are you able to do that, what kind of policies with respect to conflict of interest that implementing agency has, and with respect to ongoing project, what is the mechanism to transfer the unspent amount to Schedule 7 fund. So we may also play a very important role to devise an agreement between a company and an implementing agency, spelling out very, very clearly the responsibility of the both the parties and deliverables, and what happens if there is a breach of trust or breach of trust for the company. And therefore, that can be one important area where for need assessment, utilization, impact, conflict, unspent, and contract, covering all of this can be one area of service. When you do a due diligence, of course, you would start with the bylaws, trust deed, or MOA, and then governance aspects, policies related stuff. Then details of our projects and their documentation, how did they selected the area, how did they selected beneficiaries, what are the, how do they select the beneficiaries, how do they document it, how do they, with respect to conflict of interest, political party, how much is there on an average administrative overhead expenses, and what is the target and actual delivery performance of those implementing agencies, and what is the testimonial knowledge which they have got from the earlier companies whom they have engaged for some kind of a reference check. So these are the areas which definitely companies would look at anybody who is doing a basic health check before selecting any implementing agency. Earlier, this kind of health check were not very common, but now this will be very, very common because of the number of companies being prosecuted, because of the CFO's personal responsibility to give certificate. Because even if the CFO certified that the money has not been utilized, it is going to put everybody into trouble. And therefore, selection of a right partner is the key to success, rather than post-mortem and then blame game kind of a thing, because it is anyway going to put them in trouble. Even if implementing agency has not used that money for the CSR and it has used something else, company's obligation to do CSR is there. And if the company is not able to get the implementation done from the implementing agency, they cannot say that I have paid the money to implementing agency, now I have done my job. No, that's not going to save us. That's not going to salvage us. And therefore, selection becomes a very, very important criteria for all the and therefore the due diligence, the health check, these are the services which play a very important role. And if we are able to propagate this to the corporate community, this will definitely be helpful for them. What is that CFO would look at from us when we are giving certificate? First, he would look at is whether the profit calculation is proper, whether profit under 199 CSR rule has been derived properly, and then whether the obligation of CSR was arrived at properly. Second, he would look at comfort is whether the admin overhead cost at company level and NGO level is within limit or not. Then he would look at whether the money which we spend directly or through implementing agency has been actually utilized for the purpose. And as I said earlier, if you are distributing a school bag, would you look at the purchase invoice of the school bag and the books? Or would you want to be satisfied that the books and school bags have actually gone to the beneficiaries? Which were the target for as per our CSR policy and annual action plan? And therefore, that's the thing which a CFO would have to give comfort to the board. And if CFO has engaged us, then CFO is looking at for that comfort from us. And then ultimately completion of the activity. Because unless and until the project is completed, the company's activities is company's job is not done. And therefore, completion of activity is necessary, because thereafter an impact assessment will have to be done a year later. And therefore, these comforts is what CSR would look at. And for that, obviously, if you are providing service to implementing agency, these are the services which we have to offer to them. I am coming to the last leg of this discussion with respect to the services which we can offer. And the most important part, which will be the most valued part, and this is direct service part. Okay, because administrative overhead will have a lot of other expenses even. But the impact assessment is a service part which is, as we had discussed earlier, not every company has to do impact assessment. Only large companies who have CSR obligation more than 10 crore. And some data is available for 14, 15, 15, 16. And that data shows us that there are few 100 companies who have more than 10 crore spending in 14, 15. And therefore, the number would have gone on an average by a few hundreds. And therefore, in very soon, it would reach to 1,000 companies who would have 10 crore plus CSR obligation. If you have 10 crore plus CSR obligation and one of the project is more than a crore in a year or on an ongoing project in over a period of time, but if the project is more than a crore, then you need to get an impact assessment done. Now, if you want to enable us to do an impact assessment, how do we do impact assessment activity? Now, Asavaji, you can, at the Thana branch also, you can explore that whether you want to do program on impact assessments, and that will be one good service to all the members. Such programs are going on and being conducted by institutes since last 1 or 2 months. So what is the minimum thing which an impact assessment activity would involve? Is first of all deciding parameters. Parameters based on which the impact assessment will be done. You know, blood checking or diagnosis. Here, parameters are necessary, and parameters generally derive from lead assessment. Now, what I am trying to say here is that before undertaking a project, if the company has identified what are the objectives of this project, then that provides a raw material with respect to parameters for deciding, evaluating the impact. Parameters are very important. Otherwise, what will happen is either implementing agency can be the allegation can be made on the implementing agency that you have done a very hunky-dory, you have selected parameters which are very rosy for the company, and you have not selected parameters which will reflect the negative performance of the project. Such allegations should not happen on us, and therefore deciding parameter should be very comprehensive exercise. Then comes project area. Out of the project area, there may be whole taluka or district where the project is undertaken. How will you select project area? What will be the population coverage which you will do? These are some important parameters. Then formulation and timeline for the impact assessment process. So we'll have to suggest to them the offer. We'll have to tell them that this project, how do I propose to make an assessment of the impact? So what is my timeline? Do I have a ground level reach? Because this will require our physical presence at a taluka or village level. And therefore, one who has local area presence can only provide this support. So your collaboration and networking skills, your investment in those areas is going to be very, very useful for you. Because you have, only then you will be able to make an impact assessment. Then only then you can make the assessment of time estimate and your estimated cost, which you can factor. Then engage relevant expert. For example, if it is a water irrigation, then you will have to engage someone. If it is an education, if it is a skill, you may have to take some experts along with you. And their credentials will also be relevant for getting the work. Then engage, train, and create a platform for the volunteers who are actually going to collate this data. Impact assessment is a lot of data analysis, a lot of data collation from a right source. And therefore, devising the right question, identifying the right source, employing the right team for the ground level collation of the data, and then platform for collation of the data so that there is a complete transparency. Even if there is a third party verification done with respect to this impact assessment, remember one thing, that this impact assessment reports are going to get attached to the annual report of the company, and therefore there is going to be complete transparency, and the quality of impact assessment report is going to reflect upon our quality of the service and the knowledge of the subject. And therefore these and there can be some whistleblowers tomorrow to say that there is impact assessment is not done properly, and therefore archival of this is very important, and therefore a platform for collating data is very important. Then describe action and activities on the field. Who will travel where? How will you collect data? How will you do? How much budget you have for site visit? What are the timelines for site visit? In terms of availability of the target audience and in terms of availability of the infrastructure, all of those will need to be mapped. Then engagement of stakeholders, because they need to know what are these, why are these questions asked, and therefore training to our own team with respect to stakeholder engagement, stakeholder in terms of beneficiary, stakeholder in terms of implementing agency, and stakeholder in terms of the company to whom you are going to provide this report. All of these stakeholders, updation, their awareness, and their communication becomes a very important aspect with respect to this impact assessment. Then the data documentation, analysis of those, then wherever you see any contradiction with respect to data, cross-checking, reconciling the finding, maybe send some volunteers back to the to the ground level, site level, and collate some data again. So So you may require to do redoing of something, and therefore better you factor that in the costing before whenever you are offering your services, and then compare impact versus objective, and then obviously suggest some mechanism to improve this impact if the project is going to be continued in the next phase or so, or the such feedback is very, very vital. Now, this was the broad discussion which I thought that can be relevant for all the chartered accountants who have gathered here, in terms of, first of all, appreciating that CSR is a buzz area, and these are where the learning objectives which I had set when I prepared this PPT, that at least at the end of the session, the audience should be able to memorize or acknowledge the two data points with respect to size of this opportunity. So 25,000 crore year on year growing at 15% can be two data points. 30,000 projects, 2,500 listed companies spending on 3,500 crore rupees can be some data points. 2 points with respect to what is not considered as CSR, if you are able to recall, in terms of employee, political party, and those six baskets which I shared. 2 points which would give as an advance our CSR policy and annual action plan in terms of various parameters like thrust area, local area, national priority, impact assessment, utilization, monitoring, so many parameters we fix. Selection of implementing agency, what can be the parameters, if you are able to recall, at least couple of parameters, CFO certificate, what all is expected from us. If these were the learning objectives, and that's it, Asawaji, from my side. And it's my pleasure to respond to your queries.
First of all, sir, let me put on record of marvelous lecture, and spellbound by all the participants, there was not even a single murmur, though you had asked that you should disturb, the participants can disturb in the middle. There were some queries in the chat box, sir, and we deliberately kept it till the end because we wanted your flow to continue, and whatever contents you wanted to deliver should be delivered in that same letter and spirit. Yes, sir. Sir, there are some observations. First of all, there was a participant, Marji Pakka. He has made an observation. It's an eye-opener. I think all of us will agree with that. There are a lot of things which have unveiled in this particular lecture, and really it's an eye-opener for all of us. So, Marjiji, you are absolutely right. Then the second query is from CA Suman Kumar Jha. If the customer is a charitable institution or a hospital, can the company contribute such customer under CSR activities? It's a query raised by Suman Kumar Ji.
So probably what I understand from Suman Kumar Ji's query is that if the beneficiary is the customer of the company, is it eligible as a CSR? Now, so long as it is not exclusively for your distributors. Now, whether you are B2C, if you are, then the customer is the public. But if you are B2B, okay, and then if you are putting your customer as a beneficiary exclusively, then that will be a normal course of business. If it is generally available for the public and some of the beneficiaries happens to be your distributors or suppliers or customers, that shouldn't be a problem.
Okay. I think that must have answered Suman Kumar Ji's query. Okay, CA Mukunda Honkan, he has raised a query. If the company pays for the school bus and bill is in the name of the school, there may be an accounting or GST related complications. I hope that is his query.
Can you repeat again, Yogesh?
Yes. If the company pays for the school bus, and the bill is in the name of school, there may be accounting or GST related complications. I didn't get it actually, but this is what I...
Now the requirement is that the school should be a trust. Only then the school bus can be bought in the name of school. And only then that buying of school bus can be eligible as a CSR expenditure. Then the entire expenditure, irrespective of whether it's a capital expenditure, it's a CSR expenditure. Another important point with respect to this question is what happens to GST. I believe that GST credit will not be you will not be able to take it. If you take, then obviously to that extent it is not a CSR. And if you are not taking, then obviously it is a CSR. It's a cost to for completing the project. Other complications with respect to GST, I am not the right person. You may have to you within chartered accountant fraternity, definitely they can.
कोई क्वेश्चन तो नहीं है. सबका ये है कि इट्स अ वेरी नाइस लूसिड प्रेजेंटेशन एंड फुल जस्टिस हैज बीन गिवन फॉर द टुडेज टॉपिक. दिस इज अ जनरल ओवरऑल ऑब्जर्वेशन ऑफ ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स एंड आई थिंक वी कैरी दिस पर्टिकुलर मैसेज लाउड एंड क्लियर.
मकरन जी, देर इज वन क्वेश्चन इन द माइंड ऑफ सम ऑफ द चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट्स दैट सम ऑफ आवर क्लाइंट्स आर नॉट डूइंग वेल. एज आई डोंट हैव टू टेल यू, इन पेंडेमिक देर आर सेवरल इश्यूज इवन इन लिस्टेड कंपनीज, बट फॉरगेट इट लिस्टेड कंपनीज. दोज अनलिस्टेड कंपनीज हु आर कवर्ड इन दिस, some of them are in dire difficulty, especially cash flow. I'm not saying they are not solvent, but they are not liquid today and they don't have enough funds. My question to you is that they have asked us a query that we will not be able to comply with the CSR funding requirement in 2021. 2021, they had no good business, no good recoveries. So suppose it has to be transferred to a separate account, then it has to be spent in 3 years, all that is okay. I'm unable to do it. Practically, it is not possible. Is there any way out for those companies to ask for specific exemptions, or we should go for industry level exemptions to those industries? For example, the industry of travel and tourism, which is completely closed. Some of the aviation industry, which may be in severe difficulty in cash flow. Now, such industries, whether the general clause of 1 lakh penalty will apply, or what exactly, or whom they should approach, or how they justify of not even putting it into a separate bank account. Forget spending. I mean, the last year they could not spend, even today they don't have money to put in separate bank account. So how we handle this kind of difficult or trifical situation, not difficult, how we do that?
It's a more of an industry representation, but still few legal points I would like to
yes,
say.
Yes.
Since it's not an industry body. So, yeah. A few legal points with respect to, as you know very well, that 198 profit itself encompasses past losses, amortization. And therefore, to that extent, our obligation can come down drastically in terms of this.
Yes. Yes.
Another yes. point is with respect to the...
1 minute. Makaran, I'll stop you for 1 minute. I had a profit up to 20. So last 3 year average, which I should have spent in 2021 is a positive figure. Now the point is, yes, you are right. 21 is a big loss, which will wipe out all profit average. So 21-22, I have no obligation, probably even considering the huge loss. You are absolute. I am asking of 2021, where I had an obligation on opening 3 years and which I am unable to comply in 2021. Not even in 21-22, I'll be able to generate that, is the question.
If you are unable to claim that set off, there is one more interpretation with respect to Rule 3.2. Now, Rule 3.2 says that you have to continue for 3 years.
Yes.
And 135.1 talks about immediately preceding completion. So, to that extent, if companies take a view and also a representation compared with that, it is applicable, rule section will prevail over rule, and therefore I would look at only the preceding year. If that is having more than 5 crore profit, only then I am obliged to spend, not if I am not covered in 1. So this is interpretation, and this is getting broadcasted on live. But section and rule, anomaly interpretation, if somebody wants to take this call, you know, this is a risk, but that's a call. And third is, in terms of liquidity, you get 6 months if you pass on to Schedule 7 fund. And therefore, after the end of the year, after next September, so you get 18 months to spend to take care of this pandemic-related situation. These are some legitimate defenses which I could think of.
Yeah,
of course, making a representation to ministry that if current year I am in loss, might they absolve me from this obligation, although I might have profits in the
previous years.
Previous years, or allow me to carry it forward in next 3 years to spend, although I have not commenced anything in this year. So this kind of, I think this representation for loss-making companies, if your good office via central council, if they are able to make. We will
write to MCA from our side, but CS Institute writing would make a huge difference. Let us accept. I am also a company secretary, so I told you in the beginning. We honor all institutes are equally powerful, but in company law matters, obviously CS Institute has much bigger role to play with the government. So we will do our effort. From CA Institute, we'll write. But industry level, I told them industry level efforts are also required by travel and tourism industry, going there and saying we are totally closed. Where is the question of, I mean, we are not able to pay salaries also, forget all other government dues and all. So CSR is the comes after profit. So it's not
possible. Industry would accept, with my humble estimate, that if the company is lost in current year, and if there is a covenant that I will fulfill that in the next 3 years, allow me to carry it forward only because if you have been lost. If I'm in profit, I will have to prioritize, because then that profit I have made only after meeting all my statutory expenses, and therefore such companies would not get exemption, but loss making may get some exemption, is my understanding.
That's right. But I think one more observation is, I spoke on ESG in the beginning. That is, I am also like you, director on some of the companies where we need that kind of push by the director board on ESG expenditure, etc. Which the director board is thinking that currently government is on CSR expenditure being given in COVID, more or less. I mean, every company is supposed to, they are after every large companies spend for COVID, because they cannot manage. No government can manage 130 crore population for this. So they are absolutely right that they are pushing us for that. They are giving us credit for next year also. Please spend now and protect the community and all. That's fine. But how you will take it to ESG, you know, like there, I hope that ESG is a complicated subject. And if you can suggest branch, our branch chairman is extremely, vibrant. There's a vibrant branch and it's very proactive. Actually, you can tell him who will speak on ESG here. ESG is something of a new subject coming up in chartered accountant. We have a sustainability reporting committee in institute now for last 2 years. And we are recommending integrated reporting in future and all sorts of things. In fact, it is not in the world except South Africa. But if such type of committees are formed and ESG, we have sustainability standards being issued and so many things being done at ICI level. So if you can suggest somebody to, because that's a very huge opportunity.
Absolutely.
Sustainability is an opportunity. You talked on CSR opportunity. Sustainability is a very big opportunity for chartered accountant as a group. We are coming out with some sustainability. You know, there is a report already on sustainability, which is recommended by MCA very recently. It's very large. In fact, corporates would need professional help to really go for, filling it up and giving a proper representation in the board report. But in any case, I think if some speaker, if you can suggest, or if you yourself want to speak, because all the comments in the comment box are in favor of you, saying excellent, excellent. So if you want to say, I made that comment only because the subject is different. I am not against you speaking at all, because you have been speaking to CA profession for a very long time. I know, and I have heard you many, many times, and everybody has highly appreciated the way you put the subject even today. So I'm saying ESG is a very specialized subject, and we have very specialized people. If you can suggest somebody, I think the branch will definitely take it forward. We will relate it to CSR, but actually it's as a separate subject. And our opportunities in sustainability, all our professionals, I think that's one of the subject all of us can listen and come to that. And we have, Institute has also, I must tell the participant who are still there, that Institute of Chartered Accountant has put up a course also for sustainability. And that is already being attended by those members in industry in a big way. And that will help us, for them to actually go for ESG. So I think these kind of initiatives would help all of us to grow into different areas, non-conventional areas. So I think, but that's a very dangerous field. If you don't know that field, you are going to get caught very badly. So we need a lot of guidance in ESG. So you can suggest, just, or you speak if you already spoken.
You will take it offline. You will take it offline.
सविता ये रिकॉर्डिंग स्टॉप करा दो, कोई बात नहीं.
I think when two stalwarts are speaking, one should sit back and listen. That is what we are doing.
Nice and name. Stalwart is sitting.
We were enjoying that.